Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlilhu fala hadiya lah. Wa nashhadu an la ilaha illallahu wahdahu la sharika lah. Wa nashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولقد يسرنا القرآن للذكر فهل من مدكر صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Dear brothers and sisters, today we are going to start a class of the Arabic language of the Quran, a language which has an honor to be the last word of God, Almighty Allah, and I believe on merit. No doubt it was the choice of Almighty Allah to choose a nation or to choose a language in which the last word of Allah was to be revealed. But I believe that selection was based on the merit of this language. I have recited before you an ayah from Suratul Qamar. Surah Qamar is just adjacent to Suratul Rahman in the Quran. And as you all know, Suratul Rahman has a verse repeated again and again, فَبِأَيَّ عَلَىٰي رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. The same way, Suratul Qamar has an ayah repeated again and again, and that ayah is وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرِ. For sure, we have made Quran extremely easy to get the message, to get the guidance, to understand. فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرْ. So is there anyone who will receive guidance from this? As this is the word of Allah, it has to be true. We as believers at least do believe this. But the language of Quran is Arabic. And to prove that the word of Allah is true, Arabic language has to be simple and easy as well. But on the other hand, there is a general impression about Arabic language that this is a very difficult language. Was it a deliberate injunction from Shaitan or by the enemies of Islam that they infused into the minds of the Muslims that it's a difficult language, or it was just by chance that it happened? But the fact is that we just have an impression that it's a difficult language, and mostly the methods which have been adopted to teach Arabic language are so monotonous that method really makes it difficult. It's not the language itself which is difficult. You know, the curriculum which is usually followed to teach the language is either to learn the language in the way it was designed to teach the youngsters, the kids. You know, the parents at a time in the past used to take their children to the masjid, to the sheikh, and tell him that here's your student, you have to teach him Islam and everything. So according to the mental level of that student, a youngster, a kid, a curriculum was designed. And you know, at that level of age, ability to memorize is much higher than the ability to understand. So in that curriculum, it started from memorizing the charts of the verbs, daraba, daraba, darabu, darabat, and so on. But when the adults were to be taught, there was supposed to be a different curriculum. But most of the people, they tried to teach Arabic language to the elders also in the same way, and the result was, as the ability to memorize the things keeps on diminishing, so it was difficult for the people to memorize such a great number of charts, and as a result of that, they thought that probably it's not possible for them to understand and learn the Arabic language. Or another way to teach the language was that the language was taught with the help of other languages. It's always difficult, rather impossible, to learn a language with the help of another. Every language has got its own construction, its own chemistry, its own mechanics to express an idea, to convey the message. In English, as we know, the arrangement of the sentence is that a sentence always starts with a subject, followed by a verb, and then comes the object. Those of you who understand Urdu, which is my mother tongue also, we find that the arrangement of the sentence is that no doubt it usually starts with the subject, but it is not immediately followed by the verb. Instead, the verb comes last of all. So if we start translating, you know, we take a sentence of one language and then we consult the dictionary and get the meanings of all the words, and we start substituting each and every word with its meaning, we will not make a sentence of Arabic language, and so may be the case in any other language except the languages which are very close to each other. For example, Urdu and Persian, they are like mother and daughter. The construction of the sentence in Persian is the same as that in Urdu, but it's not so in the case of English and Arabic. It may be very interesting for you to know that the construction of Arabic language, the sentence in the Arabic language, is so different from that of the English language that in Arabic language you can have a sentence without verb, which is even difficult to comprehend or even to think of it. That can there be a sentence without verb? If you don't know about Arabic, you are only familiar with the English sentence, you won't believe it, that there can be a sentence without a verb. But in Arabic, it is possible, and it's very often practically there that the sentences are formed without the verb. What is the objective of a language? If that is in our mind, then it will not be a problem in our mind where we stuck so badly that we can't proceed. The basic objective of the language is to convey a message. I have certain expression in my mind and I want to convey that expression to you people, and I will take help of the language, right? An expression in one language to convey a certain message and an expression in another language to convey the same message may be entirely different, but the message can be the same. So my respected teacher, may Allah forgive him, he passed away last year, he defined translation, that translation means to express an idea from one language to another. One idea you express in one language in this way. The translation of that would be that how you express this idea in the other language. So it's not the translation of the or the substitution of the words. That you just substitute the word, it will be the translation. No, it will not be the translation. It will learn meanings. Translation is something different. So Quran was revealed in Arabic language. Until and unless we understand the way of expression in Arabic, that how Arabs express their ideology, their ideas, we won't be able to understand the Quran. So our objective in this class will not be to memorize too many things and to burden your minds with a lot of vocabulary, but instead we will just try to understand the mechanics of the language so that you can understand in a little time the themes of Arabic language, and then for the whole of your life you will be able to improve your vocabulary and have more and more understanding. If you don't understand a single word, you can consult a dictionary, but you don't know how to express, or you don't have the understanding of a sentence, its constituents, its parts, then you may be knowing the meanings, but you will not be able to understand the message or idea. Arabic language has got the basic unit of Arabic language, AR, like in English there are alphabets, starting from A to Z there are alphabets of English language. Similarly, in Arabic language there are huruful hija. Huruful hija. The Arabic, you can say the Arabic alphabets. They are counted as 28 or 29. This may be funny for you to listen from me that they are either 28 or 29, that there is a difference of opinion in the very figure of the total number of the huruful hija. The huruful hija are alif, ba, ta, tha, jim, ha, kha, dal, Ral, Ra, Za, Sin, Shin, Thad, Dad, Ta, Za, Ain, Ghain, Fa, Qaf, Kaf, Lam, Mim, Noon,
واو، ہا، حمزہ، یا، آر، ہا اینڈ یا. دا ڈفرنس ان نمبر از بیکاز سرٹن ایکسپرٹس آف دی لینگویج دے کاؤنٹ حمزہ اینڈ الف ایز ٹو لیٹرز، دی ادرز کاؤنٹ حمزہ اینڈ الف ایز ون لیٹر. وائی؟ کلاسیکلی اسپیکنگ، جسٹ ٹو میمورائز دیز لیٹرز، یو نو آئی روٹ اٹ ان فور لائنس جسٹ ٹو میک اٹ ایزی فار یو ٹو میمورائز اینڈ میک دا چلڈرن میمورائز ان سچ اے وے. الف با تا فا جیم ہا خا، دال زال رازا سین شین صاد، دو تا زا عین غین فا قاف، کاف لام میم نون واو ہا یا. واٹ آر دیز؟ دیز آر لیٹرز آف قرآن. میمورائز دم یا اخوان. دیز آر اونلی 28. ریڈ دیم، لرن دیم، ڈونٹ بی لیٹ. یو کین رائٹ اٹ ڈاؤن. فرسٹ دیز لائنس ان دی سیم وے یو ہیو ٹو رائٹ ان یور نوٹ بک. الف با تا فا جیم ہا خا، دال دال رازا سین شین صاد، ضاد طا ظا عین غین فا قاف، کاف لام میم نون واو ہا یا. واٹ آر دیز؟ دیز آر لیٹرز آف قرآن. میمورائز دم یا اخوان. یا اخوان مینز او برادرز. میمورائز دم یا اخوان. دیز آر اونلی 28. ریڈ دم، لرن دم، ڈونٹ بی لیٹ. If you want your kids to memorize these in Arabic, then the whole lines can also be in Arabic. Ma hazi, ma hazi, what are these? Hazi huruful Quran. Hazi huruful Quran. احفظوها یا اخوان. احفظوها یا اخوان. ثمانية عشرون. ثمانية عشرون means 28. ثمانية عشرون يحفظوها المسلمون. Muslims should memorize them. ما هذه؟ هذه حروف القرآن. احفظوها یا اخوان. ثمانية عشر يحفظوها المسلمون. In English, what are these? These are letters of Quran. Memorize them, ya ikhwan. These are only 28. Read them, learn them, don't be late. Now let us understand why there is a difference in this, that why certain experts of the language count them as 28, the others count that as 21, 29. The reason is, technically speaking, Alif and Hamza, they are interconvertible. To understand, at this moment you can say Hamza and Alif are interconvertible, but there are other interconversions also. technically speaking, alif is only one which has got no harakat. Harakat means fatha, dhamma, and kasra. In Persian and Urdu, they are called pesh, zabar, and zair. But we will use the Arabic terms, dhamma, fatha, and kasra. And the fourth possibility is sukoon, jazm. When any of the four is there, now this is no more alif, this is hamza. Hamza actually is a sound, while alif is not a sound. This is ka. But if you or even if you don't write hamza, you just put a sukoon over alif, now it is hamza. How it will be pronounced? Ka. Now it is producing a separate sound. When it was ka, it was just pulling the sound of kaf. The k sound was being just pulled in a certain direction. But when there is a sukoon, now it is ka. Similarly, when it is ka, same in the same way, now it is ak. Now it is ik. Now it is uk. Now it's a sound. But here, it is not a sound. It is just pulling the k sound. So here it is alif. But everywhere else, it is hamza. So that is why certain experts of the language, they count hamza and one as single letter. And the others count hamza and alif as two letters. We are no ones to decide that who one of them is correct. We have just to understand and just to keep in our mind that there is a difference of opinion. Okay? Now a few words about the concept of consonants and vowels. We all practically know this, but consciously we don't know it. The consonant is basically a sound, and vowel is just the movement of that sound. For example, this is K sound, but how to pronounce this? This is K sound. But now it is to be ka, ki, or ku. In which direction this sound is to be moved? This will be determined by what? Either the harakat or the vowel letter. For example, in English, if we write it according to the pronunciation, this is K-U-K-U. this is KA cap, and this is KI key. Then in Arabic we have got another possibility also, and that is instead of Dhamma, Fatha and Kasra, the plain Fatha, plain Dhamma and plain Kasra, we use the stretched ones. For example, we have got the stretch Fatha and stretch Kasra. This is Ka Fatha Ka, but if you have stretch Fatha, now it is Ka. Umar, what is this? Ki. So this was Ki and this is Ki. And then inverted Dhamma. Naman, how can it be pronounced? Ku. So this was Ku Ka Ki and this is Ku Ka and Ki. The same can be expressed in Arabic in another way also. So this can be done with same Dhamma but followed by a sakin vowel. Will give you the same effect. Ku. Then single fatha followed by an alif. Ka. And then plain kasra followed by a ya sakin. Ki. So in English also it's very important that when the word changes its form, the consonants will not change. The vowels will change, interchange, delete and add. For example, come, this is the first form. So to go to the second form, what we do? C and M, they are the consonants and O and E are the vowels. So the vowel will change only. Then to add ing, what will happen? E will be dropped, but C and M cannot be dropped because they are the actual sounds. So is it clear? So in every language there is a concept of consonants and vowels, and the same is the concept in Arabic also, but in Arabic there are two additions, you know, this is in every language, but in Arabic there are two additions. One is the plain Dhamma, plain Fatha and plain Kasra, they also act as vowels. And then the inverted Dhamma, stretched Fatha and stretched Kasra, they also act as vowels, but they stretch the sound more. They just move the sound and they stretch the sound. This is just the movement. Ku. K sound is Ku. Ka. Ki. Then Ku. Ka. and ki. Stretching. One is just the movement, other is the stretching. So, as in English, with the change of vowels, we very frequently change the forms. In Arabic also, with the change of vowels, very frequently, the forms will change. Now, forms in every language are in different categories. For example, one change is changing the verb to an abstract noun. This is also a conversion in English. Then there is a change of form from first form to second form, second form to third form. Then the adjective, the conventional adjective, then the comparative degree and superlative degree. No, these are different forms. So, when we are the students of English, when we have the format of the sentence of an English construction, and so we study different parts of speech, and in every part of speech, we understand how the conversions are made. Right? When you are studying the adjective, what you will be taught? How to make the comparative and superlative degrees. When you are being taught the number, you will be taught how singular is converted to plural. When you are studying the gender chapter, you will be taught how the masculine gender is converted to the feminine gender. And mostly, the changes will be of the vowel sounds, and certain known additions will be made. For example, ION in the end is a very common addition in English. To form the abstract nouns, what you do? You usually add ION in the end. And when we learn this subject, we come to know that in the end, ION is added. Sometimes it is SION, sometimes it is TION. But since that is known to us, that when it in the end there is ION, SION or TION, mostly it is the abstract noun. And if it is in the, it is a word is ending at D or ED, we have in our mind, oh, it is usually the second or third form of the verb. But all these categories are studied and taught separately, then there is no confusion. But if we start learning one from this, other from this, the third from this, then we will be in trouble. So systematically, you know, these things are to be kept in mind, that as here are the, you know, ing is a known addition, ion is a known addition, d and ed is a known addition, and r or est in the case of comparative and superlative, r and s, stronger, strongest, bigger, biggest. So, no, these are the shapes which are known to us. So, in Arabic language also, these things are to be kept in mind, that we will come to know mostly the changes will be in the vowels. But in addition to vowels, there are certain additions also, additional letters will also be added, and in the categories which we will study one by one, we will come to know the additions, that what shape a particular word in a certain category adopts. If that is in our mind, the tracks are there, whenever a similar word comes, immediately it will ring into our mind, oh yes, it is like this. Is that clear to everybody? Clear? In Arabic, you know, whenever the letters join, they form words. Sometimes a word is comprising of a letter, like in English, this is a pen. So, a is a letter also, and in this sentence, this is a pen. This a is not a letter, although it is a letter, but in that construction of a sentence, it's a word. In Arabic also, sometimes the words may be comprising of one letter. As in chemistry, you know, normally the molecules, they are comprising of more than one atoms. But the definition of the molecule is the smallest particle which has an independent existence. So sometimes, for example, sodium, calcium, these have got one atom is a molecule also. But in case of hydrogen, single atom of hydrogen is not a molecule. Two atoms when joined together, they make a molecule. So these are the things which are there in every language. Sometimes there will be one letter which will be a letter also, and it will be a word also. Now we are coming to words. Usually what happens is that letters join to form words, and words can be meaningful and meaningless. We are not concerned with the meaningless words. We are only concerned with the meaningful words, and every meaningful word of Arabic language is known as kalima. This ta, you know, according to the principle of tajweed, this will not be pronounced kalima. It will be pronounced as H sound, kalima. Every meaningful word of Arabic language is known as kalima. And this is of three types in Arabic language. In English grammar, it's very funny that there's no categorization in English grammar. All the kalimat are all the parts of speech. They are separately mentioned. A whole list of the parts of speech is there. In Arabic, Urdu, and Persian grammar, they are categorized into three. We are presently studying Arabic. So in Arabic, there are three parts of speech, are three types of kalima. Aqsam means kinds. Singular will be qism, and the plural will be aqsam. Aqsamul kalima. Types of kalima. Aqsamul kalima, types of kalima. Angrezi, if you can, you want to compare this with the English grammar, you can say the parts of speech. There are three only in Arabic. The first is ism. Difficult to pronounce because there is no vowel in between. Ism. It is not to be pronounced ism, but ism. Nadeem, how to pronounce? Ism. 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 In English, noun. By definition, ism is the name of an object, person, place, or act. Object, person, place, or act. keep a question mark in your mind at present when we will study just now the verb, then it will be clear why act is here. So the name of an object, name of a person, name of a place, or name of an act is called ism. Then number two, is fi'l. Again difficult to pronounce, fi'l. You know, this is vowel and this A is a constant, consonant here, fi'l, this is for ayn, fi'l. Compared with the verb of English. Now the definition of verb in Arabic is a kalima which indicates an act or position, which indicates an act or position with reference to one or two tenses, that is past, present or future tense. There has to be some reference of any or two of the tenses, then it will get the status of verb. Otherwise, it will be included into the noun. For example, to come and come, came. You know, to come does not indicate any tense. So this will be included according to the Arabic definition into the ism. But these two, they indicate the time or tense, so they will be qualified to be listed under the verb. So the name of, so to come is the name of the act, you know, the name of the act of coming is in English to come. Are coming, is coming, was coming, will be coming, now the tense is there, but simply coming, it's not, it doesn't contain any tense. So coming can be having the status of ism, but is coming, was coming, will be coming, shall be coming, now this is a verb. So is that clear? That what is meant by the name of act, that is an ism, not the verb. Then the third is harf. To have the similarity. Harf. This is no parallel of in English, so there is no parallel word for this. Harf. It is a part of speech, obviously it is a meaningful word, only then it can be a kalima, which although has a meaning, but practically it means nothing until and unless it is joined with an ism or fi'l. For example, in English, I am taking just the example of preposition in English. In is a preposition. You know the meanings of in. But you just keep on saying in, and you make the tasbih of 100 times or 1000 times, it doesn't mean anything. Although in is a meaningful word, but saying just in doesn't mean anything. Why? Until unless you say in the basement, in the room, in the car, right? In the office. Now this in is meaningful. It conveys the meaning, although the word is meaningful in itself, but it doesn't convey any meaning. It doesn't mean anything practically until and unless it is joined with a verb or a noun. So this is known as harf. In English, I've just given you the example of preposition. But in Arabic, there are many, many categories of huruf. You know, harf is singular and the plural is huruf. You can write down with each of them the plurals also. Plural of ism is asma'u. Asma'. The plural of fa'il is af'al. And the plural of harf is huruf. We have already read huruful hija. Huruf. So ism, asma, fi'l, af'al, and harf, huruf. And now you can note the interesting thing. Here, as I told you, this first is hamza. So it will be there. Look, this is there, seen is there, and meme is there. When we have made plural, there is the addition of this hamza and addition of this alif. So vowels have changed. Number of vowels has increased. Similarly here, fa, ayn, al, lam, all three are consonants. So fa, ayn, al, lam are there. There is only the addition of certain vowels. This hamza is the addition and this alif is the addition. Then ha, ra, and fa, fa, all three are the consonants. So they are there. Ha is there, ra is there, and fa is there. And only a vowel has been added in the middle to make huruf. Is it clear to everybody? Clear? So, if you revise Huruful Hija, the Arabic alphabets, 28 or 29, then the concept of consonants and vowels, then we learned about the meaningful, all the really meaningful words in Arabic are called kalimat. Kalima is singular and kalimat is the plural. That also you can note it down. Kalimat. So you won't call it kalmat, kalimat. Singular being kalima. There are three types of kalima in Arabic: ism, fa'il, and harf. Ism is a noun of an object, a person, a place, or an act. Second being the verb. Verb is the kalima which indicates an act. An act or position, which indicates the act or position with reference to at least a tense out of the three, that is the past tense, present tense, and future tense. And just to remember, you can write it down. Past tense in Arabic is called madi. Present tense is called hal, and future tense is called mustaqbal. So, madi, hal, and mustaqbal, past, present, and future. Brother Azhar, to use an ism or noun in English, how many things you are supposed to know to use it correctly in a sentence? बंद कर दें, सुबह अजान होने लगी. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم. اما بعد, in the last lecture we learnt about the Arabic alphabets, the Huruful Hija, and also we learnt about the meaningful words known as kalima, plural being the kalimat. Then we studied three types of kalima, and they were ism, fi'l, and harf. Ism, first and the foremost, is the name of an object, a person, a place, or an act. Now, in the end, I ask you a question, that in English, to use a noun in a sentence, what you are supposed to know grammatically about that noun. Nadeem, take the mic.
What are we supposed to know about the noun?
Keep the mic close. Can you keep the mic close, please?
Anybody else?
It's gender, and whether it's masculine or feminine.
I don't think in English it is of any importance.
No.
What is important in English to use a word in a sentence? What is important to know about it? Sister Sophia? Yes, that is the only thing important, singular or plural. the number of the noun, you must know it. For example, no, man goes, men go, army goes, people go. What do you understand by this? You cannot use the noun in a sentence until and unless you know the usage of that noun in English regarding its number. You know, this is very clearly singular, and men is very clearly plural. Army and people both are collective nouns. Why I brought these examples, these two examples, both are collective noun, but the usage of the word army in English is singular, and the usage of the word people in English is plural. Is that clear to you? So why I used in the present tense, brother Arif? Why I took the example of the present tense?
Because the form of the verb changes in English.
Yes, regarding number, regarding in the third person, right? In the second, in the past tense, there is no difference. I go, she go, he go. I went, she went, they went, all are went. But in the present tense, that number counts. So that is why I selected an example of four nouns in English, all being used in the present tense as third persons, and that made it clear that man goes, men go, army goes, and people go. So that indicates that people is used as plural in English, army is used as singular in English, although both are collective noun, and this is obviously man is singular and men is plural. In Arabic language, you know, one of you said that gender is of importance. Gender in English is hardly important in the construction of a sentence. But in Arabic, four things are important and they have to be in your knowledge before you use a noun in a sentence. The first thing that you are supposed to know about a noun before you use it in a sentence, or you use it in an Arabic construction, first is that whether it's a definite noun or an indefinite noun. Definite / indefinite. In Arabic, you will say whether that noun is marafa or it is nakira. Nakira ma'rafa. Don't call it nakira and ma'rafa, but they are ma'rafa and nakira. Ma'rafa and nakira. Second that you are supposed to know about a noun is its number. And as against English, in Arabic you will call it adad. adad. And keep in mind, in Arabic, there are three numbers. In English, there are only two, singular and plural. But in Arabic, plural form starts from three. And for two, there is a separate form, which is known as Muthanna. Number three is the gender. In Arabic, you will call it jins. Jins. Number four, last but not the least, rather the most important in this connection is I'rab, the status of the noun in the construction. Status, or in Arabic, this is called I'rab. This is the classical feature of the Arabic language.
Classic means unique.
Yeah. I'rab with the kasra of hamza, not arab. Arab is a different verb, that is also an Arabic word, but it has different meanings. Yes, brother.
In English, we have proper noun and common noun. Does it follow anything in Arabic?
The better word for that is definite and indefinite. The type of this, then we will find the first category will be the proper noun and common noun. The proper noun will be actually the type of marfa. The exact translation of the word marfa is definite. So, status or i'rab. You have got some concept of marfa and nakira, definite and indefinite. To say, you can say proper and common, but don't keep that in your mind. You have the concept of number, although there is a change that here the number are 3 instead of 2. You have in mind the concept of jins, the gender, plural, masculine and feminine, obviously. But this is something very new for you. So, we will start from the Arabic, so that you come to know that what the Arabic language is. And here is the beauty of the Arabic language. You know, in a, when I say the status, what does it mean? You know, in a sentence, when there are different nouns used in a sentence, they are in different positions. Their status is different. One is subject, the other is object, still other may be in some indirect position. What in your mind is that to indicate this, what we do in English? Yes, Mike.
Is it related to tense, past tense, present tense?
No, no, that is verb. How to indicate in a sentence, English sentence, the subject and the object?
Is it the word which relates the subject to the object?
No, that is the verb basically. I think we don't understand the question. Brother Arif?
My brother gave me a ride, where my brother is subject and I am being object.
How you indicate this?
Subject comes first in sentence?
Absolutely. Yeah. That is the indication. Very correct answer, that in English, it's the arrangement of the sentence which tells you that one which is coming earlier is the subject and one which follows the verb is the object. But it can be other way around also. Nadeem? Can it be other way around?
Yes, it can be.
How?
We can make the object as the subject, you know, by putting it.
No, that is passive voice. Don't change the verb. In that you have to change the verb. The passive verb has to be brought. One is to give ride. One is ride to be given. So the verb changes.
Alright.
In the active form of verb, verb being the same, is there any possibility to change? No, not in question mark.
If we change the sentence in the passive voice?
No, that is he has already said.
The verb has to change, right?
No, without changing the verb.
In English?
Yes. Sister Sophia? No? You add some preposition to the object. To me, he gave the pen. Normal construction is he gave me a pen, but you add two before me, now two will indicate that this is the object. Now you can replace it from here to there with two. If you have got some indication, then you can bypass the arrangement and you can express the same idea in the same verb.
And the verb is followed by subject, object.
The normal arrangement is first the subject, then the verb, then the object. But in this, the object has been brought earlier. To me, he gave the pen. You know, one of the, there are two objects in this sentence. Me is also object, pen is also object. But one of the objects was brought earlier. But you have to have some indication. Remember, in English language, you have to add some indication apart from this noun itself. In Arabic language, it's the classical feature of the Arabic language that you are not bound to the arrangement of the sentence. The expression of the noun will be in such a way that that expression will tell you that this is whether the subject or the object or something else. This is clear from the from English. If you want to have a parallel example of Arab, that is the cases in the pronoun. For example, I was going to office. My car broke down. A friend gave me a ride. Who is this?
Subject.
No. When I am saying, say, this is my name, Abdul Sami, or any one of you is saying that his name, say, I is Abdul Sami. Who is this? And who is this? But why three different words? No. I have used for myself three different pronouns, although the person being the same. What's the reason? Anybody?
It is because of the status of the noun?
Of course. My status in this sentence is subjective. I am in the subjective position, nominative position. So, I use the nominative form of the first person singular pronoun. This is also first person pronoun, singular, first person singular. This is also first person singular. This is also first person singular. Person being the same. When I was in subjective position, I used the nominative form of pronoun, nominative case of pronoun. In this sentence, my position was secondary. You know, the verb is broke down. Who broke down? Not myself. Car broke down, but unfortunately that car belonged to me. So, in secondary position, I was being mentioned. So, the possessive case of the first person singular pronoun has been used. Then in the third sentence, what is the verb? Gave ride. Who gave ride? A friend. Whom he gave ride? Me. So, I am in the objective position. My status is that of an object. So, the objective case of the pronoun was used. You know, now this change from I to my and my to me, this is actually comparable with the change of i'rab in Arabic language. Is it clear? This is the i'rab, this is the nominative i'rab, this is the possessive form of i'rab, this is the objective form of i'rab. You know, here when it is the specific objective case has been used. Now, suppose somebody asks you a question, whom he gave right? You can say, me he gave right. Now, when me cannot be used for the subject. So, if I bring this me earlier to this, grammatically the sentence will be okay. Our objective in studying i'rab in Arabic language, and this is the main thing, the one to whom this concept of i'rab clicks, he knows Arabic. It may click him in the first sitting, in the first class, in the fourth or fifth session of the class, but the moment it does, Arabic is open to him. Until it does not, Arabic will not be open to him. So, be very, very clear about this. Me can be brought earlier. Me, he gave a ride.
Me or to me?
No, it's not necessary to say to me. When me is there, in case of the first example that I took, what was the example he gave me?
To me, he gave the pen.
Yes. To me, he gave the pen. No. To me, I use that word there. But you, instead of the pronoun, you bring the noun there. For example, Ahmed gave Muhammad a book. Now, if you want to bring this earlier, you will have to bring two. Otherwise, when it is obvious, the me has been used, then it's not necessary. In certain cases, it may be required. That is the requirement actually of the verb sometimes. Some idioms, they require that the idiom is only meaningful when that particular preposition is there. In that case, it is necessary. But in the case of give, it's not necessary to have the preposition afterwards.
If instead of Muhammad, we had me,
then you can do. Then you don't have.
This rule,
yes. No, no, actually that is, you know the English better than me. Mm-hmm. But I just want to convey the concept that if the object has got in itself the noun, in itself has got the indication of being the object, then you can move it from there to there.
Location can be changed.
But in otherwise in English, normally noun doesn't have the indication in itself. It is either the arrangement or it is the addition of some preposition which makes you aware of its status. Is that clear to you? I have said the same concept in other words. That normally in a noun, in English, in pronouns is not the case. The pronouns, there is specification. But in nouns, normally, noun itself doesn't have the indication. You will have to have additional indications. Now I come to the Arabic language. Muslims. What is the Arabic of Muslims? What else? Muslimuna, Muslimina, now when you are using this word Muslims in an Arabic sentence, you will see whether in that sentence the Muslims are in nominative form, possessive form or objective form, and accordingly you will choose. Muslimun also means in English Muslims. Muslimin also means Muslims, and this Muslimin obviously is also Muslims. But to use them in Arabic language, you have to be clear. Before you use, you have to be clear that in which form or which status that noun at that particular moment is. Okay.
What is the difference between the two Muslimin?
Just read, read, read.
Muslimin pronounced.
The words are the same. Like in English, you know, in you know, in English, we took the example of the first person. In first person, the nominative form is I, possessive is my, and objective is me. And in first person, third person, singular, masculine, you have got he, his, and him. But in third person, singular, feminine, you have got she, her, and this is also her. With practice, you differentiate between the two. With practice, you will differentiate. And in the context, you will decide that, okay, this is whether the possessive form or the objective form. Just like this. So, nothing to worry. But every form, you cannot say, you know, when there are separate words like this, then you can say, oh, it is either the possessive form or the objective form. But when it is in the construction, you have to decide, you have to know it, there will be only one form. For example, I gave her the pen and this is her pen. When you know English, you understand that in the first sentence, the her is the objective one, and in the second example, the her is the possessive one. So, when separately speaking, you can say, what is her? You will say it is the third person feminine, possessive, oblique, objective case. When separately you are asked, what is Muslimin? You can say it is either the possessive or the objective case. But when it is in the sentence, then there is no R. You have to be clear that in this construction, this is the objective case, and in this construction, it is the possessive, possessive case. Is clear? So, i'rab is the status, i'rab is the status of a noun in an Arabic construction. I'rab is the status of a noun in an Arabic construction. Similarly, to be more clear about this Muslimun, to understand this concept very clearly, I wrote it Muslims. Now I am writing Muslimuna and Muslimina. How you spelled it? M-U-S-L-I-M. Muslimuna. And Muslimuna can be written like this also. Agree? Nadeem, do you agree with me?
Yes.
Then this is Muslimina, and this can also be written like this. And Muslimina. Now, what's the difference between the two?
There is any.
How?
It's just the how you use zeir, zabr, and pesh. It's just a different form of writing.
No.
Has anything to do with gender?
No. It is just the change of i'rab. But what I want to indicate is that only the change in vowel has changed the i'rab. This is M-U-S-L, M-U-S-L-I-M-I-M. This is double O-N-A and this is double E-N-A.
How would you pronounce the other one, the way we have written it?
Same, pronunciation being the same. This is also Muslimun. This is also Muslimun. This is also Muslimin, and this is also Muslimin.
Oh, but we're doing Muslimuna.
Do it like this. You know, in 1977 in Pakistan, there was a movement against the Prime Minister of that time. The movement was known as Nizam-e-Mustafa movement. The movement to implement Islamic order in the country. The Prime Minister of that time, he was the victim of that movement. So finally, he was cornered and he implemented certain things. Instead of Sunday, Friday was declared to be the holiday, and gambling and drinking was banned. Then addressing the press conference, he announced these things and he said that the opposition wants Islam. And yes, look, I have implemented Islam. What more they want? Now there was an aged journalist, he asked, "Sir, this is not the whole Islam. In Islam, there is no concept of president and prime minister. There is always an Amirul Mumineen." Then Mr. Prime Minister replied very beautifully, "Then make me the Amirul Mumineen." So, just put a fatah over here. Yes.
So when I don't think I understood your question first time. So your question was, what is the difference between Muslimoon and Muslimin, the two different forms, not the way we wrote.
That is just the way of writing. You can write it like this, you can write it like this, you can write it like this, you can write it like this. But in both the cases, mm-hmm. one difference is there, and that difference is of expression. I said the noun is expressed in such a way that indicates that it is the subjective form or the objective form. So Muslim, you have to pronounce meem, seen, lam, meem, noon. Meem, seen, lam, meem, noon. It's only the movement of meem. Whether you do it moo or me, rest is the same. Only this change in the expression, how you pronounce the word. When you say Muslim moo na, it is different, Arab. And when you say Muslim me na, it's a different Arab.
It changes the form from subject to object.
Yes. The status has changed. Yes. This is subjective form, this is objective form, and possessive also. Is it clear? You are lost.
I'm just trying to understand.
Arabi in principle is the game of Arab, in principle. If you understand the concept of Arab correctly, you know Arabic. Rest are the details. But if you don't understand this very concept, you may fill your brain with the vocabulary and you make your brain a dictionary of Arabic language, you don't know Arabic. So take as much time as possible till you understand this concept.
So the second form is object and the possessive noun.
You forget, for the time being, you forget about this detail. Just understand that the form has changed. And what changes have taken place? Only the way of expressing it. Muslimuna, Muslimina, only that much is a change. How it is written, this way or that way, that is the second question.
Does that make any difference?
No, that doesn't make any difference. Muslimin can be written this way also.
Meaning remains the same.
Meaning remains the same. But main thing is the sound. Mm-hmm. How you pronounce, how you express. Muslimuna, you know, you move the meme in the reverse direction. Muslimuna. And then you bring it, pull it down. Muslimina. That is the change. But the thing is, Muslimn, you know, if I omit the vowel sound in between and only I pronounce the consonants, that is Muslimn. And then between the M sound and the N sound, there has to be some vowel. And that vowel determines the era. In this case, now we take the singular form. The singular of the Muslims is Muslim. In Arabic, again there will be N sound in the end. So, in three forms, the Arabic translation of the word Muslim will be what's the difference?
The vowels change.
Only the change of vowels. Look, everything being the same except a vowel before the last end sound. Here also there was a vowel before the last end sound, you know. In the end again there is a vowel which is common. Here it also it's A, here also it's A. But the last consonant was N and just before N, the vowel sound was different. The vowel was different which determined the Arab. Here also the last is the N sound and the vowel sound determines the Arab. If it is Muslimun, it is
subjective
form. If it is Musliman, it is the objective form. If it is Muslimin, this is the
possessive
form. Now according to sound, if we write it, Muslimun, Musliman and Muslimin. But practically it is not written like this. You know, this N sound is produced by some other way. That's a way of writing, and that is the tanween is used, the double harakat is used. Double dhamma, then Musliman, remember this, double fatha is always written on an alif. That's like foran, taqriban, you know it already. Taqriban is written like this, yaqeenan.